Hi and welcome to Control Theory in Practice. In a recent video I discussed why your organization could benefit by introducing control theory. This time I will try to explain what control theory actually is. Anyway, I have recently discovered that there is a control theory also in sociology, for which I know very little. Well, in reality I don't know anything about that. Just for clarification, in this video and throughout all this channel, I will consider that control theory that was born for solving engineering problems. But this of course shall not prevent you to stay with us. I mean, if you want to listen to something different, which can be possibly located far away from your comfort zone, you are more than welcome to stay with us. And at the end, if you like the video, put a like and consider to subscribe to the channel. Let's start. Control theory, also known as automatic control, is all about decision making and is the most natural approach for solving engineering problems simply because it somehow resembles what happens every day in nature. Nature takes decisions every day. For example, a plant that is doing a photosynthesis for creating its own food, or your body that starts to sweat when it gets too warm, underpin some sort of natural decision making process that Mother Nature is doing for you. But you also take more or less active decisions every day. For example, when you are playing with the water knob of your shower, or when you are signing some multimillionaire contract with your business partner, or even when you decide to marry that girl or that guy, in fact, you are executing some decisional making process. The study of decisional processes exists since a very long time and spans over a large number of disciplines, and control theory fits here very well. In particular, that field that is called decision analysis aims at finding methodologies, tools and software for helping us in taking good decisions. And guess what? Control theory actually studies methodologies, tools and, if you want, even software for helping us in taking good decisions. The particularity of control is that it's extremely rigorous simply because when it has been developed, there were no other choices. I mean, when you are sending a man on the moon or while you are fighting the Second World War, you cannot make mistakes, and the only way to take the right decision is to follow a strict and rigorous approach that provides you some sort of guarantees that the decision taken will have the desired effect. Perhaps someone noticed that I like history. Let's refine a little bit what is control theory. In very short, control theory studies decision methods based on available information for achieving a certain goal. Hold on, I can already imagine the faces of some of you after hearing this weird sentence. I promise you that things are easier than you believe. So, let's try again. What I say is that control theory studies decision methods based on available information for achieving a certain goal. Now, if we carefully look into this definition, we can spot three ingredients, which are goal, available information, and decision making. These three guys represent the pillars of the whole control theory. The goal is essentially what do you want to achieve. Like, for example, I want to go to San Francisco by car. The available information is what you have. For example, what is my car, how much fuel I've left, what is the traffic condition, what is the weather condition, plus the current state with respect to our goal. In this case can be our current city that we can assume it's Los Angeles. Finally, the decision making process tell us what is the best thing to do according to some metric to achieve our goal. So, namely, to go from Los Angeles to San Francisco given the information that we have. As an exercise, let's try to spot these three pillars in the examples that I showed you before. In the photosynthesis example, the goal of the plant is to eat. The available information is that there is no nutrient left, and the decision taken is to perform some photosynthesis for producing some food. In the case of our body, the goal is to keep our temperature within an acceptable range, and the available information is our actual temperature, and the decision taken by our body is just to sweat. In the third example, our goal is to be profitable. The available information is all we know about our partner, and the decision to take is if sign or not to sign a contract. In the last example, our goal could be simply that we want to get married, and we have some information about the guy and the girl, and the decision taken in this case is tricky and it's an eternal problem because we can take it by following our heart or following our brain. I know, everything seems so obvious, but in reality we tend to disregard the importance of these three pillars more often than we believe. So just to show that, let's make some example where I remove one pillar per time and let's see what happens. How often we heard that it's extremely important to have clear goals before starting any sort of activity? And how much time we spend in clarifying our goals? Well, that's easy to say, but we know that this does not always happen. For example, in my experience in embedded software development, I have often seen software developers diving into coding without not even letting me finish to explain what the software was supposed to do. And the outcome of this behavior often led to very interesting results. Obviously, the absence of clear goals is not only a software development thing. The same happens in project management. It is well known that if we don't have clear goals and it's not clear what the project shall deliver, then the project is most likely to fail. And guess how often this happens? Imagine now that we have a clear target, but we don't have enough available information, but yet we start doing something. Then in this case we risk to waste our time, or to never reach the goal, or if we reach it, we may not reach it in an optimal way. For how much it sounds bizarre, this scenario is also fairly frequent. For example, how often do you read a lesson learned document before starting a new project? Or how funny it is to hear, hey, but we already did that, after you spent countless sleepless nights for developing a solution. And even worse if on top of that someone say, oh, and what you have actually works better than what you are proposing. Just for the sake of completeness, what if we have a clear goal, we have rich available information, but we get stuck and we don't take any decision? For example, what if we want to go to San Francisco, we are in Los Angeles, but we are driving towards San Diego and we keep in driving towards that direction? Okay, we can drop this example. If you keep in mind these three pillars and you unleash your imagination, you can see how much you can fit here, and you can do that continuously. Even now, for example, I assume that some of you are watching this video because they want to understand better what is control theory and they are not very familiar with it. In my experience, this simple mind trick helps in reinforcing our thinking and it clarifies our ideas. And often after that things get very exciting. Of course, this mind trick can apply in many areas. As an example, let's see how to use to exploit these three pillars in the field of communication. Assume now that a large organization, like for example IKEA, has a new CEO that wants to send a strong message to the investors. After he explained all the things about the financial report that all the CEO have to do, he want to send an additional strong message and he want to leverage on the vision and mission of the company. For those who don't know, the vision of a company, it's a wanted position in the future. It's a sort of ambition on where the company want to be in some years. While the mission is what the company is actually doing for chasing their vision. If we map organizations' vision and mission in our framework, it's not difficult to understand that they are actually goals. So now let's formulate a great message by considering the goal and by adding available information and decision making. Last year, we had about 8,000 articles in our catalog with very competitive prices. This year, we have pretty much the same number, while our main competitor launched 2,000 new articles in the market. We further experienced that many customers with the IKEA family option didn't perform any purchase to us. No need to blame external forces like pandemics and such. It is only our responsibilities. We established our mission back in years and we firmly believe in it, but unfortunately we have to acknowledge that we are departing from that. We are disappointed, but we will not disappoint you, nor we will disappoint our customer. For this reason, the plan for the next year will be a deep reorganization that will include big changes in the leadership team. We will implement a new way of working and will establish clear responsibilities and product ownership.
Actually, I don't know if that example was catchy enough. But anyway, were you able to spot these three pillars?
Well, good. I mean, the example that I give in communication was just an example to show the how to use these three pillars in many contexts which are not directly connected to engineering. But what about the engineering world? I mean, at the end, control theory was born for solving engineering problems. So let's take a look at that. In that case, depending on the application, the goals can be safety and comfort, reliability, fuel consumption, and so on. The information in embedded systems is typically provided by the sensor, or it comes from the network, from the cloud, and so on. And the decision making process typically run on a computer. So someone can say, okay, so control is the software. Well, not really, but don't worry, this is something that always happens to mix up what is control and what is the software. To clarify the difference, I often make the analogy with a book. So for instance, what I say that a book is written with a certain language, it uses a certain font face, it has a certain cover with a certain color, and there is a content. Now, all these attributes like language used, pages, font used, and so on, represent the software platform, while the content represent the control strategy. Both are important, of course, but who is more important for winning a Nobel Prize? In the same way, we can see the software split into platform and application. The platform includes the selected programming language, the processor used, the drivers for the I/O ports, the communication protocol, and so on. And the control is the algorithmic part that runs over it. The result is that control is a concept which is even more abstract than software, and therefore it is often referred as the hidden technology. But watch out, because this does not mean that the application software shall be developed by following a trial and error approach. Well, of course you can do that, but then you will run unavoidably in problems like software growth with no control, people that start fighting with each other, misunderstandings, and a lot of various things that I have discussed in one of my previous videos. In a complex system, you can see control as a glue that connects many components, or to use another analogy, you can see it as the director of a big orchestra. Now, an interesting fact here is that the director of an orchestra may not be able to play any instrument, but we all know that it's fundamental for making all the magic to happen. So someone can ask to the director, okay, so you work in music, but you cannot play any instrument. The same thing may happen in control. So you are an expert in control, but you have just some basic of programming in C.
So at the end, what is control theory? Well, as said at the beginning, control theory studies methodologies, tools, and if you want, even software for helping us in taking better decisions. And it is based on three pillars. It is most likely the most rigorous approach in the branch of decision analysis. Interestingly, perhaps the most famous conference in control is called the Conference on Decision and Control. I hope that this video clarified a little bit what is control theory. But before finishing, I want to leave a message to all the control theory purists that are watching. I understand that the definition given based on three pillars may appear it's incomplete, it's not rigorous enough, that's fairly naive, and I could agree with you. But on the other hand, I found this definition very useful and effective for introducing many people to the world of control theory. Nevertheless, if you found some bug in this definition, or if you have a better one, or if you just want to suggest some improvement, or you want to say bad things about me, please write a few lines in the comment section below. While the final message for all is that if you like this video, please consider to subscribe to the channel, hit the like, hit the bell icon, share with your friends, and blah 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 blah. That was all for today. Thank you for watching and see you next time.